They're not the core of the recording.
My name is Imam Sohail, Chaudhry, and I'm the newly appointed Imam here at the Islamic Center. Welcome everyone. I am so happy to see all of you, and I hope that this event will be a fulfilling event, an educational event, that it will open up new avenues and new doors for further collaboration and peace efforts. I would like to start off with a recitation from the Holy Quran. The first chapter of the Holy Quran, followed by a verse from the second chapter, which I thought was appropriate for this occasion. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim.
evening, everyone. I'm so pleased to see so many people here this evening. My name is Paul Brundell Ray, and I am a member of the Lansing Church of the Brethren, and I'm also the representative on the board for the Peace Education Center for the Lansing Church of the Brethren. Just over the past year or so, there's been this crisis in Nigeria that's been occurring with Boko Haram, and it has had a significant impact on the Church of the Brethren, and there's people here who will speak about that. And as a result of that, I felt the need, and other people in the church felt the need to do fundraising to help with relief efforts in that part of Nigeria. And I felt the real need, and along with Cindy, our pastors of the Stegada Barnum, that we should do an educational event. And it kind of changed from just a kind of a Christian interfaith, from a Christian event to an interfaith event, is what we were hoping. So we hope that you're here. We have three panelists, and we're going to have them present a short statement for about maybe 10 minutes, and then we'll have questions, and we can either entertain questions from the floor, or we will pass out cards if you'd like to ask a question, if you don't feel comfortable asking a question directly. Okay.
Why don't I pass these out?
Okay, but that, okay.
Just so they can ask, they think of a question.
If you think of a question, you can write it down and we can have that. On our panel today, we have, right here immediately to my left, Professor Dauda Abubakar, who is a professor at the University of Michigan in Flint, and he is a scholar, an African-Nigerian scholar, and he's going to give us some good perspective, I believe, on the situation in Nigeria. Immediately to the left of him, we have Cliff Kindy, who is a member of the Church of the Brethren. He has worked with, as a volunteer for, the Church of the Brethren Disaster Ministries, and recently returned from northeastern Nigeria, where he was doing relief work there. He's also a Christian Peacemaker Team Reservist. What that means is he's been in various conflict areas with Christian Peacemaker Teams, and is ready to go to certain conflict areas whenever called. He spent a lot of time in the Middle East, and he's also an organic farmer. Actually, that's how he makes his living, is by farming. And then to the left of him is Thasin, Sardar, and he's going to give us kind of the Islamic and Muslim perspective on Boko Haram. He is the outreach coordinator for the East Lansing Islamic Center. And so these are our three panelists today. And I think I would like to start with Professor Dauda to kind of maybe give us kind of an overview of the situation in Nigeria. Oh, you have a lot of people.
Perhaps I will start by thanking the organizers of this program for inviting me to come and share my perspective about what is going on in Nigeria, especially the northeastern part of the country. If there had been PowerPoint facilities, we would have been able to use a map to be able to show for those that may not have an idea about the geography of Nigeria and the location of the places where most of the violence has been going on. Basically, there are three main states that have been most affected by the violence. The states are Borno, which is very close to Chad, and then Yobe State, originally where myself and my family are from, and then Adamawa State, which is to the south eastern part of Borno and Yobe States. The Boko Haram violence began from about the year 2000, late 1990s, and one cannot specifically say it is only about religion, although religion is a very important factor. The group, of course, started as a religious, Islamic religious group. But some of the supporters of Muhammad Yusuf, who was the first leader of the group, were also part of other political parties and political groupings within Borno State. And it was an internal rift between Muhammad Yusuf and the former governor of Borno State. His name is Muhammad, Senator Ali Sharif, right? Now that rift eventually, of course, degenerated into violence between Muhammad Yusuf's group and security agencies, and it escalated into attacks against churches and Christians, and of course a lot of churches were destroyed. A lot of Christians were also killed. Some pastors, including one pastor from our church, slaughtered. So that was the early phase of the violence. But after Muhammad Yusuf was killed by the security agencies, Boko Haram then escalated the violence, from targeting Christians and churches and soldiers and schools. They escalated it to include everybody that opposed them, Christian or Muslim, male, female, children, whoever it is that they felt was opposing their own brand of Islam. And that brand of Islam, according to them, is a more pristine form of Islam. But we will not go into those other details. But those were the three states that were part of the where the violence took place mostly: Borno, Yobe, Adamawa State, but especially in Maiduguri, which is the capital of Borno State, where Muhammad Yusuf had his headquarters. And there were also other parts of the north, like Kano, Bauchi, and as far as the federal capital, where sometimes some of you may have heard on the television that there has been these attacks taking place in some of these other cities. And at the end, of course, the victims sometimes would be Christians, sometimes would be Muslims. By then it had escalated and become a full-blown terrorist activity, if we should put it that way. Lots of people being killed, irrespective of their religious faith, and it got out of control. It was not until about 2012, that the federal government in Nigeria decided to impose a state of emergency in that region. But by then, a lot of the population had been devastated. And at the receiving end, of course, would be women, children, and the elderly, those that are the weakest in the society, in the community, that were displaced. It is estimated, and this is an estimate, that about 12 to 15,000 people so far have been killed, and another 1.5 to 2.5 million that have been displaced. So they have been internally displaced within the country, but they have been displaced from their homes. And most of these, of course, were not only from within the major urban centers like Maiduguri and Gamatu and the Mubi area in Adamawa State, but also from the rural areas. But one important thing that happened was that around 2012-2013, the civilian population within Maiduguri that were the most affected decided that they would join hands with the security agencies in order to flush out Boko Haram from within Maiduguri itself. And I think the lesson for us there is this, that when people come together and say that there is a problem and we want to solve it, the human spirit is enormous. Our Creator has given us as humans tremendous power and capabilities in order to address social and political and economic problems. And so that was what happened within Maiduguri itself. They felt that it's enough. They wouldn't take it again. They flushed out Boko Haram from within Maiduguri itself. And that was how the city became relatively peaceful. It became, at least people could continue with their normal livelihood. They can go to offices, they can go to markets, etc. Although from time to time there would be attacks, but at least they were able to flush out Boko Haram from within Maiduguri itself. But then the rural areas were the ones that were at the receiving end now. Konduga, Goza, Baga, parts of Yobe State, Mubi, etc. That was where you had many of the rural population, farmers and the peasantry that were then affected. They were not well protected, and most of them had to again relocate into Maiduguri, some of them into churches, some of them into schools in order to gain protection from the security agencies. And the question therefore that I want us to reflect about before I hand over the microphone to my colleagues is this, that what is it that we can do as people that are in this part of the world? What can we do to help those that are caught in this major turmoil? And as most of you know, that once there is a problem somewhere else, it can also affect us even though we feel we may be far away from it. And I have about five quick points that I will go over, and maybe some of it will come in the process of the discussion. I don't want to take too much of the time. One of them is the importance of humanitarian assistance. And there are many people within this group that are already involved. From my conversations, I have heard about some that have already been there, that are already doing relief work, that are already trying to assist. That's very good. So humanitarian assistance is very important. The other second thing related to that, of course, is raising awareness. To raise the awareness of people within this country about what is going on in other parts of the world and its implications for us that are in the United States here. To be able to understand it and to be able to approach the problem in an ethical way, if one could use that word. Because unless we have an understanding of what it is, we may not be able to appropriately respond to the problem. The other important part of that assistance would be rebuilding the infrastructures that have been destroyed. Many schools, for example, have been destroyed. A lot of places of worship have been destroyed, churches, etc. And you can imagine, for instance, what that means, especially for those that either their schools or homes or churches have been destroyed, that will need that type of support. The other third point that I would want to mention is the significance of interfaith initiatives and Nigeria is a country where you have about, let's say, 75-80 million of the population would be Muslims, and an almost similar number, maybe about 65 again or 70 plus million that are Christians. So it is a country that is literally divided into two, Muslims and then Christians, of almost equal population. So Nigeria as a country has a lot to teach us, I think, as people. And I always tell my students that if Nigeria can survive as a country, then people should be able to also live together. There would be differences in terms of faith, religious beliefs, race, gender, etc. But that it is important. Because if it's a country that we say must solve its problems through violence, you can imagine what that will mean for the region and for the whole world. 170 plus million people at war with themselves, that could be very tragic. So working with non-governmental organizations, community-based organizations, religious leaders that will be involved in talking about what is going on in Nigeria within the communities, especially in the Northeast now, is very important. And I think developing a network of interfaith communities with civil society organizations to try and make sure that Nigeria's leaders are as transparent as they should be in running the affairs of the nation. Part of the problem of corruption and the looting of the treasury in the country contributes to some of the violence that we see in the northeastern part of the country. A lot of unemployed youth, a lot of people that feel they have been excluded from government, from the resources that the country has. All these things feed into the violence that has been going on. I've taken a lot of time, but I believe that this might help provide us with the context. It's too sketchy. I would have loved that if we had a map, but I hope it will help us in the conversation, a very important conversation this evening.
Am I on?
Yeah.
to speak from my experience as much as possible. I spent 3 months in Nigeria this winter, December, January, and February, returned home the 1st of March. I served as a link between the Church of the Brethren here in the United States and the crisis management team of Ecclesial Yanama on Nigeria, the Church of the Brethren in Nigeria. The Church of the Brethren is unique in many ways because the three states that are most impacted by the violence of Boko Haram are the three states where EYM has its main presence. So, many of you would remember the kidnapping of over 300 young women from a school in Chibok about a year ago, a little over a year ago now. And for me, that was probably a beginning point. I hadn't been to Nigeria before. Sorry, I haven't been there. My experience has been with Christian peacemaker teams. I've been in conflict zones like Congo, like Iraq, like Palestine, Colombia, Mexico, other places. But I haven't been to Nigeria until this year. So the church there was scrambling. You know, what do you do when 4 out of every 5 pastors have had their churches burned, or are in a location where the violence prevents you from meeting for worship? What does it mean if 10,000, or I think the number was 3,000, I think 3,000 of their members have been killed, and maybe hundreds of thousands have been displaced from their communities? How do you go on? I mean, for most of us here in this country, had that happened to us, we would have just closed the doors, folded up. But they see it creatively as a new opportunity, an opportunity to expand, to renew their vision of what the church could be, and to grow. Boggled my mind. But I was there helping with food distribution. We were working with displaced persons camps, in contact also with refugee camps in neighboring countries, because hundreds of thousands of Nigerians also fled to neighboring countries. We were trying to deal with the trauma. If you've watched your family members be killed or kidnapped, or your house burned, or your business destroyed, you're very emotionally impacted. So how do you deal with the trauma? What about advocacy? There's no way EYM itself or the Church of the Brethren here in the States can deal with the kind of disaster that has happened. Finances won't spread but a little ways. So how do you contact USAID? Who's going to go to the U.S. Embassy? Who's going to check with European countries? What about European aid? What about Muslim aid around other places around the world? What kinds of things can help to bring society back together? One thing that has been clear to me from my experience is, yes, many churches were burned, many Christians were killed or kidnapped, but probably as many Muslims have been killed by the violence as Christians. Boko Haram made no distinction. If you didn't believe, as you said, if you didn't believe like they believed, you would be given a chance to convert. If you didn't, you would be killed. For me, one of the questions to ask is, in dealing with the violence, is the only answer more violence? Around the world, that's how we do it. If there's violence, we try to get bigger violence to overcome it, to stop that violence. Well, in the places I've worked, it appears to me, from my humble opinion, that more violence only makes it worse. It only adds fuel to the fire. If violence worked, it's clear to me that the United States would have won in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Libya, in Somalia, wherever. We lost. And so the are there other tools? And for me, from my experience working in conflict zones, I think we have tools of nonviolence. And one tool of nonviolence is what you're using right now, listening. You know, it's a very simple tool, it's one we all have, but to listen is a tool of nonviolence. But I think our toolbox is lots bigger than that. I think there are tools that provide opportunities to transform violence, to overcome violence, to shape a new future, a different future. So, as we were meeting with different groups there in Nigeria, one of the ways we were doing that was through interfaith meetings. Elections are often difficult times, or can be difficult times in Nigeria. That didn't prove the case this year very much. But one of the things that we tried to do was have youths, Muslim, Christian youths, looking at what the options were. How do we build a society that we can live in around elections? So that's one piece. Another piece is, you know, if all of a sudden shootings started all around us, we'd flee out of different doors, and we wouldn't connect like some of you are Christians. You wouldn't all go out one door, or Muslims, but I mean, you'd go out the nearest door. And so that's what happened in Nigeria. Everybody fled when the violence came, and you ended up in the same place. My brother and I ended up in the same displaced community. And so one of those communities near Buku, north of Abuja, is an interfaith camp. It's an interfaith camp. When I first visited there were 100 people. By the end of my time in Nigeria, there were 700 people there. I think it was people recognizing that if we can't learn to live together, then this explosion in the northeast corner of Nigeria is going to destroy the country. And so they said, we have to learn to live again. So they were building houses for everybody, whether they were Muslim or Christian. They were building schools, because there were no schools. I mean, the three northeast states, schools have been closed for more than a year. But, I mean, the children keep growing. What's going to happen to them? So they're going to build schools there. They're going to build clinics, because people need health care. And they're going to build places of worship. Place of worship for Muslims, place of worship for Christians. And I think that kind of model provides hope. For me, that provides hope. That if it can happen together, we can live together. You know, Nigeria can be a model for the world, as you mentioned. It has that possibility. As I come home, I say, okay, you know, a lot of the same things, the same emotions are happening here in my country, here in the United States. What do we need to be about here so that we don't end up like Nigeria right now? Well, I think this kind of event is that. We're here together, sitting side by side, Muslims and Christians. And if you're like me, I haven't spent very much time in mosques. I have been in mosques. But I need to spend more time in mosques, invite Muslims to my church. So we learn to know each other as human beings. That's another tool in our tool chest of nonviolence. So I want to encourage you to be thinking about what are the tools of nonviolence that each of us have that can have an impact on a situation like what's happening in Nigeria. I think I'll stop there.
Thank you everyone, and assalamu alaikum, which means peace be upon all of you. Once upon a time, the Muslim world was known as being the most tolerant as compared to the other faiths at that time. Jews and Christians were free to practice their faith and the rights were protected by the Muslim rulers. There have been multiple occasions in history where Jews were persecuted by Christians, and they were welcomed in Muslim lands, and they were allowed to settle down there and to practice their faith. For example, the Spanish Inquisition of 1492, where the Jews had, it forced Jews out of wherever they were, and they had to resettle, and they did that in Morocco and in North Africa, and they were protected there by the Muslim rulers. Fast forward to modern times, and it is sad to see how that now it is the opposite. Opposite has become the norm in the Muslim majority countries. Religious persecution has become commonplace in several predominantly Muslim majority countries. Non-Muslims and even Muslims are being persecuted for what they believe in. This is a radical shift in tolerance. And today, Europe and America, generally speaking, are more tolerant of faiths and political diversity. While it is true that Islamophobia is rising in the West, but still, as anyone who lives here can attest to, a Muslim can by and large practice their faith freely in America, and they do not have to fear being killed or bombed or physically harmed. The same cannot be said, unfortunately, in some of the Muslim majority countries, where the minorities are living under constant fear of attacks. The primary origins of Boko Haram, as Professor Dauda mentioned, their origin is not in the Quran. They are a manifestation of socio-political issues of that region. When despotic regimes rob people of jobs, decent living, stability, and furthermore, if they push them into chaos, then they develop and practice weird cultic and messianic ideas. And when they are repressed brutally by the regimes, young people are drawn to them, and they tend to idealize, romanticize such groups and freedom fighters. This is entirely due to a lack of reason, and they tend to become diabolical. As Muslims, it is very important for us to acknowledge that whether it's Boko Haram, ISIS, or Al-Qaeda, the people who are carrying out these attacks in the name of Islam are indeed Muslims. That's something we as Muslims need to acknowledge. Their acts are not Islamic, but they claim to be followers of Islam. So as hard as it may be, as Muslims, this is something we need to accept. And denying that is not helpful. We have to confront the issue. It is also important that we condemn the action, and we should not simply resort to the argument that they can't be Muslims. After all, every person is responsible for his or her own actions, and they will all be judged by God for their own actions. Our religion tells us that when there are oppressed people that are massacred, raped, you stand up and defend them. There is a term for it, it is called jihad, and yes, it is in the Quran. However, this is also a natural human law, and it is common sense as well. No religion teaches that when atrocities are happening, you just sit down and watch and let it happen. No religion will teach you that. But where Boko Haram, ISIS, or Al-Qaeda make a mistake is that they conveniently overlook what is forbidden in the Quran. Perhaps they skip the verse in the Quran that says, "O you who have believed, seek help through patience and prayer. Indeed, God is with the patient." And then perhaps get another verse of the Quran that says, if you save one life, it is like you saved all of mankind. And if you kill an innocent being, it's like you killed all of mankind. And our Imam recited a verse earlier to the effect where there's no compulsion in religion. This is also mentioned in the Quran, and groups like these conveniently overlook it. Now, these are examples which we can use to confront such groups. So beat them at their own game. If they are using religion to justify their attacks, we have to get back to them using the same justification, proving that what they are doing is incorrect. There are plenty of young men and women and girls in this world who are disillusioned in life. They think that they will find self-worth, happiness, and importance by joining such groups. Why do people join gangs in our streets? Because they attain an identity. They feel important and empowered all of a sudden. Religious people don't join gangs. The proper way would be to do a jihad of the soul, which is abstinence, service, spirituality, etc. But the misguided of the people, they take a different approach. They take a shortcut approach and end up joining such groups, hoping that they are thinking that they're doing something good. When Prophet Muhammad was entrusted with the leadership of Medina, the city of Medina, one of his initial proclamations was that non-Muslims should be able to practice their faith, and furthermore, their rights needed to be protected. Thus, in today's world, when Muslims, so-called Muslims, harm people of other faith or encroach upon their rights, they are basically breaking the covenant that Prophet Muhammad established in what we believe is one of the earliest secular constitutions ever written by mankind, if not the first one. In the West today, there are double standards in reporting, and this is very important for us to take note of because it influences how people perceive and develop opinions. Why is that when America bombs Iraq, the headlines in our newspapers say shock and awe? It's not some kind of entertainment fireworks that you need to be awed by. This is death and destruction. You should be shocked and appalled instead. Aside from the critics of the war itself, which was a big lie, we have to bear in mind the colossal loss of life that has followed these wars. According to the conservative estimates, 1.3 million people have died, and some other estimates put it at 2 million people as a result of direct and indirect effects of the wars. Yet the crimes of ISIS, Boko Haram, they are the ones that seem to stand out. No doubt that their crimes are heinous, atrocious, and they need to be condemned. But let us not forget that it was our President George Bush who started the mayhem in the Middle East, and he did so in the name of God as well. He reportedly said, and I quote, "I'm driven with a mission from God. God will tell me, George, go and fight these terrorists in Afghanistan," and I did. "And then God will tell me, George, go and end the tyranny in Iraq," and I did. And he will use the word crusade to describe his vision, which is very unfortunate for a sitting US president to use. We all heard about the torture reports that were being presented in the media. Last year, there was an American soldier who pleaded guilty of being part of a kill team that engaged in killing Afghans for sport. And this week, Blackwater guards were found guilty of killing several Iraqi civilians. And during the first war of Iraq war, the then Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, she said, "All things considered, the death of half a million Iraqi children is a price worth paying." If you're wondering what does this have to do with Boko Haram or ISIS in context of today's discussion, I feel compelled to draw this comparison because while the crimes of Boko Haram are reported as if they're motivated by religion, those done by others are not. We as Muslims, we cringe whenever we hear of a horrific attack that happens anywhere across the world. For one, we feel sorry and saddened by the fact that innocent life is lost. And then we have to put up with all this labeling that happens in the news, associating it with Islam itself. The Obama administration has actually abandoned using the prefix Islamic terrorists. When they mention terrorists, they want to delegitimize these groups that commit heinous acts and try to associate it with Islam. We have 1.6 billion Muslims who practice Islam around the world, and for the most part, all of them practice it peacefully. Now, the motives of these groups, like Boko Haram or ISIS, they may be political, but their acts are entirely criminal. There is no earthly religion that will sanction such acts. So we should not let Boko Haram and others to hijack our religion for their selfish motives. Also, if I had the means to send a message across overseas, what I would send is, America is a religiously tolerant, respectful of ethnic and racial diversity than most other countries around the world. Islam is in fact flourishing in America, unlike any other Western country. And Muslims in America are very tightly integrated in the society, and there is no public or overt discrimination that we face. This is the message I would like to send abroad, if I had the means to. And on the issue of condemning acts by groups like Boko Haram, for us it is sometimes we feel like it is as if we are approving of our faith with the people who are performing these acts. On the other hand, if we don't condemn them, such violent acts, there are some that infer that our silence is an approval of those acts. Now, despite the dilemma that we face, our representative organizations still make the point to issue statements of condemnation. I myself, I wrote an open letter to Boko Haram back in 2012, February 2012, when they had burned down a church. I was shocked, and so were my fellow congregants here, and we wanted to do something little that we could. We actually found an email address for Boko Haram while doing a Google search. So I wrote an open letter, whether or not it reached, I can't be sure, but we did do it. And in fact, I shared this post on the Facebook event page for this event from back from February 2012, if anyone wants to read it. And recently, over 120 scholars from all around the world, Muslim scholars, they got around and they wrote a letter to ISIS. This letter is available online again. There's a website, it's called lettertobaghdadi.com. Baghdadi is the self-proclaimed head of ISIS. And the scholars basically used Islamic text and jurisprudence to debunk every single point that ISIS uses to justify their actions. And I think interchangeably using ISIS and Boko Haram, it so happens that ISIS pledged their allegiance to, Boko Haram pledged their allegiance to ISIS. So that they are both evil, and you can call that marriage from hell. And sadly, there are also some thrill-seeking or delusional people, or the confused youngsters, loners, social misfits, who find new glory by joining such groups. So how can we prevent the next attack? It's very important that we deal properly with the optics of perception. We need to stop associating the faith with such actions. And we have to dismiss the notion that there's a perpetual clash of Eastern and Central values. Likewise, my message to my fellow Muslims is that scholars like Sheikh Yasser Khadi and Professor Tariq Ramadan, who's a great thinker and philosopher, they have called upon Muslims to interpret text in the context of the modern world we live in. This is not to say that Islam is ancient or that we need to modernize. No, far from it. This is a call to bring awareness to prevent people from making literalist interpretations of text in order that we can build pragmatic societies that can coexist in harmony and in the present-day secular surroundings. Promoting the image of a world full of enemies creates a security psychosis that misshapes our view of the world. Finding new threats is always a good business for someone, you know, who profits from such things. Thus, a real conversation should be, why are we in this perpetual cycle of violence, as Cliff also mentioned. We all know that extremism thrives on extremism, and we cannot bomb our way through everywhere around the world. And we should shift from the doctrine of painting Muslims as inherently evil. As believers, it is important for us to keep the faith and to be optimistic. Earlier this month, Muhammadu Buhari was elected as the president of Nigeria. He himself is a survivor of an attack by Boko Haram on him. We must also celebrate the many other Nigerians who have contributed positively to the world, particularly Nigerian Americans. Former NBA star, Hakeem Olajuwon. He was a very humble person and he did a lot of charitable work and continues to do so. We have Nigerian physicians, engineers, and professors such as Dauda, Abubakar, who are contributing to our communities. We have Sani Abbas in the audience from the Islamic Center, who serves at the State of Michigan at the Correction Department. He initiated blood drives at our Islamic Center, and we do twice a year. Do blood drives at the Islamic Center. So in closing, I would want to say that we must all cooperate together, even if we all differ in our theological backgrounds. And we need to listen to each other. And we have to make the world a better, safe, better place for our children so that love can prevail for the future generations. We have much more in common than we not have in common. And we have to work together to dispel fear. No religion encourages wanton bloodshed and violence. Every religion wants peace, not just for its own people, but all of humanity. As people of faith, let us come together to work towards this idea. May God grant peace to all of us. Thank you.
I'd just like to mention that I'm sitting in as moderator today for Professor Emeritus David Wiley, who is from the African Studies Center, we were hoping that he was going to be here today, but he couldn't be here today because there was a family medical emergency he had to deal with. And I'm trying to do the best that I can in his stead. Before I open the floor to questions, I have a few questions that I would like to ask, and then we'll open the floor. And yeah, if anybody has questions, yeah, Carolyn, could you pick up the questions? Okay. And then we'll kind of do that as well as from the floor. I guess one question I have is, there recently were the elections in Nigeria, and there's a change of government that has occurred, and apparently this has been unprecedented in Nigerian history. And I guess I would like some comment from anyone from the panel, maybe Professor Dauda, about how you view that, and if you think that there's a good possibility of something positive coming out in the future.
Well, I think that's a good question, Paul. The change in government that he was referring to was the election that took place about 2 weeks ago in Nigeria, where President Jonathan, who is a Christian, lost the election to Muhammadu Buhari, who is from the northern part of the country and is a Muslim. Whether that is good for Nigeria or not. It is important to underline the fact that, one, it is the first time in the history of the country where you had an election of that magnitude being conducted relatively peacefully, without an outbreak of mass violence. In other words, the person that lost picked up his phone to call the winner and to congratulate him, which means that we begin to see the maturity of politics in Nigeria, if I should put it in those terms. In other words, you begin to see among the elites themselves the realization that politics should not be about a zero sum, that if I lose, then it is the end of the world. There is a gradual realization now. Former President Jonathan has set a precedence in the country by doing what he did. He did it out of his own volition. If he had wanted to derail the process, he would have decided to say, well, I don't agree with the outcome. My people from the Niger Delta, from where there is a lot of oil, we cannot accept the result. But he did what is expected of state person. And that, I believe, is a good thing for the country, that he decided to acknowledge the outcome of the election. The other good thing again is that the winner himself, Muhammadu Buhari, would now such a way that he would not allow religious frictions to continue. As he mentioned earlier on, that Buhari himself was a target of Boko Haram, right? And so I believe that what we begin to see in the country is positive signs of some form of closing the rift, especially among the elites themselves, and the possibilities of that also trickling down into the population and people beginning to cooperate with one another in order to move the country forward. Maybe there might be other comments that my fellow panelists have.
I would just add one thing. As I, from my experience, and I'm an outsider, I recognize that, so you can feel free to correct me. But my understanding is that newly elected President Buhari has had a fairly good reputation in terms of anti-corruption. He has stood against corruption, and I think that's one of the serious problems in Nigeria, that the wealth of the country has been siphoned off for a few rich, and it hasn't benefited the population. And so, in that sense, I think this is a good, that's one good aspect of the election.
I'll just make one quick addition. And I really like to appreciate the former president, Goodwill Jonathan, for making a graceful exit for the office. It's not very common in that part of the world, on the eastern side of in Africa, for that matter, where an incumbent president would let go power so easily. The other thing I would like to add is the new president, Buhari, is 72 years old. Hopefully, he has all the wisdom behind him and the experience. He's been in the army, and now he's a civilian president. And with the fact that he's already survived the Boko Haram attack on him, hopefully he will use his wisdom to bring more peace to the country.
I guess I'll take some of the questions that were given on cards here. We have a few. And I guess one question, and there are a couple cards here that kind of address this one, is why did the previous government not negotiate or fight with Boko Haram in the early stages? And what is the new government planning to do with those girls that they are holding? And someone else had a question. What's the current status of the kidnapped girls in Nigeria? And that was a question I also read. So if you can throw that out there at this point.
Well, the issue of the 200 plus girls that were abducted from Chibok is certainly a very tragic incident, very painful, not only to the parents but also to the whole community. As well as the whole nation. One of the things that it has done is that it kind of galvanized the country to oppose what Boko Haram was doing, because it exposed what the real nature of the group is in terms of its attitude towards innocent persons. The information is that most of the girls may still be in the camps, especially in Zambeza Forest, which is the last stronghold of Boko Haram. Most of the other territories that they control has now been recaptured. The only other place that they are left with is the Zambeza Forest, which is fairly thick in terms of security agencies being able to access where they are. But from my readings and from the information that I keep getting about the situation, the security agencies themselves wouldn't want to use maximum force in attacking this final stronghold of Boko Haram because of the concern for those girls and many other innocent civilians that have been abducted. Because apart from the girls, there are many others that were abducted. So the security forces wouldn't want to use maximum force in trying to rescue these girls that have been abducted. But I believe that with the new government and with the intelligence information that they already have, coupled with the fact that Boko Haram has lost most of its territory, my own intuition, and I may be wrong here, but my intuition is that they are eventually likely to be able to rescue quite a number of those that have been abducted. Some may have been given out, perhaps, to Boko Haram commanders and soldiers in quote-unquote marriage. But it's possible that with the new government and the new confidence that the security agencies themselves have had because of the successes recently, that they may be able to eventually bring this to a relatively successful conclusion. Maybe someone has any other comments?
I was replaced in Nigeria by a friend, Peggy Gish, who had spent lots of years in Iraq with me. And two reports this week that just came about Boko Haram and the women from Chibok that she shared. One was, well, first back up just a little bit. After the kidnapping, there were about 50 that escaped. Some of them are at school here in the United States, some of them in Yola, working through American University, they're getting their training so they can take the exams. But this week, Peggy wrote that there was one woman who was kidnapped by Boko Haram, that there was a video that was put out by Boko Haram. She was given an opportunity to accept the Boko Haram faith, refused, and was stoned. So there's a video of her stoning. That was one that came out. But another woman and her child recently escaped from Boko Haram in Goza. There's one of their headquarters. And she reported that there are women from Chibok that are still being cared for well and are still alive. So it just confirmed what we said, that yeah, there's possibility.
Another positive story that came out of the region perhaps about 2 weeks ago is I believe the Nigerian military had overrun the Boko Haram headquarters, and which was one of their very initial places, and it was a stronghold. So let's keep them also.
Cliff, I was informed that there were a number of Church of the Brethren girls who were part of that group that were kidnapped in Boko Haram. Is that the case?
Yes.
Yes. So many of the girls that were kidnapped were actually members of the Church of the Brethren in Nigeria, which is essentially an indigenous church now. It was started by missionaries who went there back in the early part of the 20th century, and now it's its own church. It actually rivals the church. No?
Way bigger than the church.
Way bigger than the Church of the Brethren in the United States. There are two questions that I have here that are kind of related, and I'll read one and then the other. It says, to me, I think the problem in Nigeria is not a religious problem, but a political one. And what's your opinion about this? Then the other question says, I'm a PhD student at MSU, and I'm not an expert on Nigeria, but I have noticed that many conflicts globally with the religious element are largely ethnic, political, and resource-based at their root. I am wondering if this is the case in Nigeria. More specifically, to what extent do you think the British colonial period set the stage for ethno-religious conflicts as it has in other parts of the world? So basically, religion versus politics, with ethnic and resources being also at the root of conflict.
You're actually very right. Invariably, all these groups that carry out these attacks and self-proclaimed goals that they have, or ISIS calling themselves as a caliphate, they're all political in nature, but they use religion to justify their means. Also, to galvanize support. If a political party just sprung up, it's not easy for them to build their base. But when they use religion, it's pretty easy to brainwash the people of the same faith, particularly the youngsters and, as I mentioned earlier, those who are trying to seek an identity. President Obama recently held a forum, it was last month, against how to tackle terrorism in that part of the world in particular. And he made it a point, as I said earlier, to distinguish between terrorists and religion. He said, let's not give them a chance to legitimize their actions using the name of a religion.
I think it's a very important comment, the person that was asking the question. What is going on is that you find a situation where people would use religion for political ends. They turn religion for private, personal gain. And when that takes root in a society, it becomes very destructive. Whether it is the Quran, or it is the Bible, or the scriptures, people can always use, can quote from these texts to justify their actions. While in the real sense it may be so contrary to what the original meaning and the intention of what it is in those texts. In the Nigerian situation, Boko Haram and several other groups even before Boko Haram had used, in the name of Islam of course, violence and attacking people that are of other faiths. And the political elites in Nigeria also have not helped matters. They have used religion for accomplishing their own political gains. And that is what makes the situation even more complicated. And it's the same thing also with ethnicity, ethnic identity. What the elites always do is that they appeal to people's sentiment, either based on religious faith or ethnic affiliations, so that they can gain political power. They come to power. And the second part of that question about the impact of colonial rule, the impact of British colonial rule in particular. British colonial rule did indeed entrench divisions in the country, but we should note also that Nigeria has been independent from the British for the last 50 years plus. Okay? This is a country that has a resourceful population, as was mentioned earlier on, a major exporter of oil in the world, and has gained a lot of resources from that. But the leaders have failed the people in Nigeria. They have become very self-centered. They have only served their own interests rather than the interests of the majority of Nigerians. But here again is where a community like this becomes very important. As Americans, I think one of the ways that we can influence this type of event is that we should also insist that our leaders here, in Congress in particular, would ensure that some of the resources that are looted from countries like Nigeria don't end up in our financial institutions here. Right? Most of the resources that are stolen from Nigeria, from many other developing countries, that money finds itself into European countries and North American countries, in financial institutions. And so our obligation and our responsibility is that we also tell our leaders to make sure that intelligence communities and security agencies work hard on issues of money laundering. Because that is what eventually also leads to human trafficking. Money being passed across one border to the other that sometimes cannot be accounted for. Sometimes it is money that has been stolen. Money that should have been used for education. Money that should have been used for providing health care and infrastructures in countries like Nigeria. But they end up being looted out of the country. So it's a combination of so many of these factors. As I said from the beginning, we cannot say it is just about religion, or it is just about ethnicity, or it is just about resources. All these factors come into play. But I think the leadership also is an important factor, and the leaders in Nigeria have not done much to help the nation. But I think with the coming of Buhari, let's hope and pray that things will change for the better.
I'm kind of debating that on my question. One of the questions said, how does the West Bank information inform Boko Haram? That I think was the question directed to how does Western financial institutions influence Boko Haram or something to that effect? And kind of related to that also, from my question for me that kind of relates, is we know that countries like Nigeria are rife with corruption and that there's extreme poverty. There are very rich elites and very extremely poor people in Nigeria. And you know, how does that play into all of this, you know, as well?
Yeah, the first part of that question I think about financial institutions was what I was saying earlier on, that the way that US and US intelligence communities can help is to address the issues of the money laundering, so that resources like that sometimes don't either filter into US financial institutions, or that such resources sometimes don't end up helping groups like Boko Haram, right? Because once there is money laundering, then it becomes easy to procure arms from other parts of the world, and then those arms end up then being used in some of those violent theaters. The other aspect about poverty, I think, is also very important in the sense that one of the reasons why Boko Haram was able to get support was that they were critiquing Nigerian governments, whether at the federal, at the state, or at the local level. And that critique that they were making was legitimate about how Nigerian government were so corrupt and that they are not helping the population, the people that they say they are serving. And that, of course, made the group very popular. Many unemployed young people felt that, well, this is a message that they would want to embrace. And so they embraced that message, they joined Boko Haram. They could see how the resources of the country was being diverted into private individual pockets to the detriment of education, to the detriment of health services, to the detriment of infrastructures in the country. So that, in fact, poverty in particular, was an important factor. I can recall very well that if one goes to Borno, for example, where Boko Haram became very strong. By the time you get to the periphery of the city, if you go to the northern part of Borno State, you travel for about 3-4 hours before you get to the Chad border. You find that the road that was built maybe since about the 1960s has not been fixed. Schools that were built have been left unattended. Dispensaries and hospitals that have been built in the 70s have just been left. So the local population have been left to fend for themselves. And that was why Boko Haram was able to spread very quickly. You know, as soon as they were driven out of Maiduguri, they were able to conquer and capture that part of the state, because the people, after all, have been neglected by the government. You know, so they easily just embraced that message, unfortunately. But I hope that with the new government, that there will be positive change.
One thing that was clear to me in Nigeria was that Boko Haram was getting funding. They had no trouble getting finances. They could have access to whatever resources they needed and weapons they needed. And there are different theories about that. Most people would say that there were people high up in the government that saw the opportunity to use Boko Haram for their own benefit. And they discovered now that Boko Haram used them for their personal benefit instead. So that's clear. I wonder sometimes, you know, historically, Islam came first into Nigeria before Christianity and brought education, political governance. And because of that, back to an earlier question, when Britain came in, they used that ability, that structure, infrastructure that was there in Islam to control the tribal regions, the middle belt of Nigeria. With the coming of missionaries to Nigeria, with Christianity coming to Nigeria, several of the things that came with that mission movement were education, health care, drilling wells, agricultural development. And unfortunately, I think there's been a back and forth. Maybe under Islam, there weren't benefits for the traditional tribal groups or for Christians. And maybe under Christian missionary development, there wasn't an equal opportunity for people who weren't people of the Christian faith. And so Muslims tended to lose out at later stages. And that meant government jobs weren't as available to them as it was as they were for Christians. And so is there a way, I mean, ideally, public education would serve whoever. And maybe the disadvantage is that each faith saw its advantage in educating its group more than the other group. And so if there are ways that we could be more balanced, recognizing that education should be given to everyone, whether they're Muslim or Christian, maybe we can begin to break down some of those barriers.
I have two questions that are kind of related here. One says, the leaders of ISIS and Boko Haram use verses of the Quran to justify killing of non-Muslims. How do Muslims in Michigan deal with these verses? Do they ignore them or rationalize them? Or are they accepted as the will of Allah, but the time is not right for acting on them? Then the other question, it's sort of related. Given the diverse interpretations of Islam, which are exploited for political purposes, what are the chances for an Islamic reform action by which to overcome the destructiveness, sort of like the Christian Reformation had accomplished, so that Muslims can live in the modern world without giving up their integrity?
On the first part, where the verses are used by groups such as Boko Haram, as I mentioned in the course of my talk, there are verses in the Quran that call for jihad. But invariably, as a matter of fact, every single verse that calls for wars is basically an act of defense, not an act of offense. If you are being attacked, then yes, you are asked to do jihad to protect yourself, your family, and your village. When Boko Haram tries to use verses to kill non-Muslims for that matter, or to kidnap, they are basically in violation of the Quran. Even prisoners of war are guaranteed rights in the Quran. And these groups are basically violating the rules. Even livestock, trees, they are all supposed to be protected based on the Quran. It's the context that needs to be taken into consideration, and that is exactly what the 120 scholars got together and wrote this open letter to Baghdadi. You can go and visit lettertobaghdadi.com, where it's in different languages, where they use the very same verses which Boko Haram tries to misrepresent and misuse. They've tried to debunk those. On the second question about reform, reform is important, but it has to come from within. And it has to come from reputed leaders. We do not have a pope in Islam. So for the lack of that, it has to still come from somebody who has influence over the 1.6 billion Muslims. How do you get somebody to do that? And this is where I think educated Muslim communities can play a big role. And as I mentioned in the course of my talk, influential scholars like Sheikh Yasser Qadi, who's very well respected in the US, and Professor Tariq Ramadan, who's very well respected in Europe and in the US, they can play an important role in trying to get the message across to the rest of the Muslims, to basically reinterpret some of the text, not to change any text, that would be contrary to the faith, but to reinterpret things so that you can adapt to the modern day secular values. And for that matter, as I mentioned earlier, in the very first constitution which we believe was penned by mankind, Prophet Muhammad in Medina basically gave rights to people who were not Muslims. He gave them rights and for their rights to be protected. It was known as the Sharia of Medina. You can look it up online. And it was required upon Muslims to not only protect them, but they had also evolved a system as part of this constitutional effort to levy taxes in order to help the less fortunate. So these were things that were there already in Islam, which is needed back to the basics.
I have one more question I think we may have at this point, and it says, if someone here would like to make a donation for humanitarian aid in Nigeria, what are the suggestions of the various panel members? And I would also add to that, what other advocacy things could one do to try and influence our government in terms of having a positive influence on what's going on there?
Well, I think that's the first part of that question is it's very good that we gathered this evening, raising awareness, more understanding, and people are already asking of, okay, what can I do? Translating our talk into action, you know, let's walk the walk, walk the talk, they say, right? Which is very good. I think one of the ways to do that would be to get in touch with the organizers of this program. On the panel already, there is someone who has been working with humanitarian groups on the ground in Nigeria, that they go there. And from my conversations with him, he already knows the terrain. A couple of other people from the group here have talked about how they have been in Nigeria since the 1960s. And I was telling one of them that even though it looks as if the cloud and the storm is overtaking the seed of the work that they did years ago, but that there is something happening, it's positive. And we should not give up. We should not give up. There are several groups that are on the ground and are doing good work, and it's possible to connect with them from some of the organizers of activities and events like this. We are also willing to make available to you contacts that we have back at home of people that are committed, are very sincere, very honest, and are willing to work with groups that are ready to help, especially communities that have been devastated by this violence. And we are willing to give that phone number and names and contacts at the end of the program. From within the United States here, one of the ways, as I said, that we can influence the policy is through our representatives in Washington. People that represent us in Congress, if they have offices within our communities, let us go into those offices and make statements or write letters to say that this is the right approach that government should adopt in addressing some of those problems, whether it is Boko Haram or it is ISIS or it is Al-Qaeda, etc. That there is a need for civil society to put pressure on our leaders so that they would do the right things.
There is a petition on the end of the table there. It's from the Church of the Brethren, but anyone can sign it if you want to read it and sign it. There's also a sign-up sheet in the back. If you want to put your name and email address, we can get information to you. You know, that way electronically if you're interested. And we'll only do that on a one-time basis, so we don't want to harass people with emails. I don't get too many emails myself sometimes. Anyone else?
I want to encourage us to think about how we stay involved. There are lots of media sources that are helpful, I think, to give us perspective on what's happening there. And just to stay interested in what's going on, or be in touch with people like our brother Dauda, who has contacts in Nigeria, I think it's important for us to stay aware of what's going on, stay up on the news. That's one piece. Again, I want to mention what we've done here, come together as people of different faiths. I think that's key in our world today. To do that in a variety of ways, inviting students into our homes, visiting with other faith centers, I think any of those are appropriate. Because it's not an issue that's just Nigeria, it's an issue that is global. And to realize that we're complicit in it also is an important step to take. One of the places that I was involved, I talked about refugee camps. Communities, too, are going to be to try to think about rebuilding a community that's lost everything. It's not like starting from scratch. It's like starting on the other side of scratch because the wells have been contaminated, bodies thrown into it, the houses have been destroyed, the crops have been burned, the bridges are destroyed, the hospitals, the schools have all been destroyed, the places of worship, mosques as well as churches, have been destroyed. How do you start over? And to look at USAID was one of the groups that was visiting the refugee camps, and they were looking at the possibility of building schools. Nigeria may have the capacity to rebuild all the schools, but I don't know that it's going to happen very quickly. So for a group like USAID or for the European Union to go in and say, or to encourage, for us to be encouraging them to do that, I think is an important step to take. So there are lots of ways we can get involved. Oh, one other. I went as a volunteer to walk with the people of Nigeria. And they're looking for volunteers to be willing to stay 3 months at a time. So if you're interested, check out.
I think that's about as much time as we have. We're going to end the program with an interfaith prayer. Did you have a question, Carolyn?
I'm just aware that we do have brethren here from...
is an important step to take. One of the places that I was involved, I talked about the refugee camps. Communities, too, are going to be to try to think about rebuilding a community that's lost everything. It's not like starting from scratch. It's like starting on the other side of scratch because the wells have been contaminated, bodies thrown into it, the houses have been destroyed, the crops have been burned, bridges are destroyed, the hospitals, the schools have all been destroyed, the places of worship, mosques as well as churches have been destroyed. How do you start over? And to look at USAID was one of the groups that was visiting the refugee camps, and they were looking at the possibility of building schools. Nigeria may have the capacity to rebuild all the schools, but I don't know that it's going to happen very quickly. So for a group like USAID or for the European Union to go in and say, or to encourage, for us to be encouraging them to do that, I think is an important step to take. So there are lots of ways we can get involved. Oh, one other. I went as a volunteer to walk with the people of Nigeria. And they're looking for volunteers to be willing to stay 3 months at a time. So if you're interested, check it out.
I think that's about as much time as we have. We're going to end the program with an interfaith prayer. Did you have a question, Carolyn?
I'm just aware that we do have brethren here from a number of places around Michigan. If somebody wants to make a donation to the Brethren Church, what should that be written to?
I think Church of the Brethren, Elgin, Illinois, on the credit line, Nigerian.
Okay, so Elgin, Illinois, Church of the Brethren on the credit line, Nigerian relief.
And we can take that here tonight if you want to.
If people want, yeah, we can do that.
I'd like to thank our panel for being here, and thank you to the Islamic Center for hosting us this event. One of the things that we talked about as we met as an interfaith community, and I do also want to know that we're going to move quickly because I want to be respectful that at 8:30 is prayer time at the Islamic Center. But we did want to, one of the things that we all talked about that was very important to us is prayer and praying for our brothers and sisters in Nigeria and holding them into the light. Another thing that we thought was really important is to have it truly be an interfaith event and not just a Christian and Muslim event. And so I've invited Rabbi Zimmerman to join me in this time of prayer. And I'm going to have him begin by leading us.
Let us pray together, each in our own way, to the one God with a thousand faces. How, dearest God, can we know it is truly you when each of us sees a different form, hears a different voice, knows a different truth? We know you are the true God because your heart bleeds from the slaughter of innocents, from the brutal massacre of children, women, and men created in your image, from the savage persecution of young girls whose only wish was to learn, from senseless carnage committed in the blasphemy of your name and in the name of a noble religious tradition. We know you are the true God because your tears water the earth, scorched by the burning of villages, by the leveling of mosques and churches erected to praise your glory, by the destruction of schools where children learn to understand the wonder of your creation, and by the eradication of the legacy in stone of how our ancient ancestors had praised your essence in archaic forms. We know you are the true God because you brought us together here this evening. In the face of despair, you endowed us and the people of northern Nigeria as well with the gift of hope. In the wake of the devastation in Borno, in northeast Nigeria, your dedicated followers from the EYN, from the Brethren Church of Nigeria, have resisted the seductive urge for vengeance and clung to your doctrine of peace. Even as French Muslims and Christians stood with my people in Paris last month, proclaiming, "Yes, we jouis," so can we, in this holy place where we assemble tonight, whatever our faith, proclaim that we are truly brethren. Dear God, we beseech you for the love to heal a hate-filled world, for the wisdom to know how to safeguard life without destroying life, and to silence the guns without firing more guns, for the comfort for those who have suffered at the cruel hands of their fellow human beings, and for the humility to work together despite our differences. Drawn together tonight by a peril at the opposite side of the globe, Let us remain united as a force for good in our own community as well. Let our diversity yield diverse insights and diverse talents. Let our disagreements be the grounds for dialogue, understanding, and collaborative solution. And may we never cease in teaching peace, sustaining peace, and embodying peace. And let us say, Amen.
I invite you, if you're able, to stand as I offer a blessing. First, I ask that we just take a moment of pause and silence as we lift up our world, as we lift up Nigeria, as we feel the unity in this room. Let the light of hope go with you, giving you courage. Let the strength of your faith guide you. And let the hope for peace encourage you along the way. May we continue to be united in peace. May we continue to go forth in respect and in love of all God's people. And the people said, Amen.
Amen. I thank everyone for coming. If you want to speak to me or anyone else, or if you'd like to put your contact information or find out more about relief activities, come and speak to us. And at 8:30, Cliff has a DVD of Crisis in Nigeria. One of the people from the church, he has a couple copies here, if anybody would like a copy. One of the videographers from the Church of Brethren Disaster Ministries took some pictures there. At 8:30, is it at 8:30 or
8:30?
At 8:30, you're welcome to participate in the Islamic prayer, which will occur at that time. So thank you very much for coming. I appreciate it very much.
And you'll all do me a favor if you can help yourself with more food. Thank you.